So Amazon Web Services this week released their Agentic AI stack, also announcing $100 million in investment. Will it make much of a difference? Let's talk about it. So welcome back to AI Insights Innovation, where we talk about the emerging world of artificial intelligence and how to make it work for your enterprise, what you should care about and what you should not care about. I'm your host, David Linthicum, author, speaker, B-list geek. Let's get started. So as I mentioned, AWS unveiled their stack, I guess, Agentic AI stack called Bedrock AgentCore. And the purpose is to provide enterprises with an enterprise-grade platform for designing, building, and deploying and operate AI agents securely and at scale. And so the key goal will be to help organizations transition from the experimental to the production-ready AI systems for critical business processes. And this thing is able to provide modular service stack, providing core infrastructure such as runtime memory, identity management, observability, API integration, and web browsing and code execution. So this is truly, you know, going to be a complete stack product that they're pushing into the markets. In other words, if you're looking to build and deploy AI, agentic AI systems, Amazon is saying we have the capabilities of doing this. And what this typically is and what this is in this case is a cobbling together of lots of different technologies that they've already built into some sort of a packaged offering, which they can provide to the market. And obviously, you know, with the analysts in the room, you know, explaining to what it is, why they're relevant in the space, why they're innovative, all that kind of stuff. And also the fact they're going to spend $100 million on this. They did announce that as well. So will that make any difference? Because agentic AI kind of now is a market that's already emerged. It's, you know, 2 or 3 years old based on, you know, what I've been looking at. But by the way, it's older than that. We just happened to be more interested in it 2 to 3 years ago. And is AWS going to be able to gather up market share when I don't see them having a large market share around the agentic AI frameworks now? So let's talk about what's the good and bad aspects of this. So I guess the best way to describe AgentCore is a list of a lot of stuff. So they have a runtime, they have serverless low latency execution environment, multimodal workloads, you know, with session isolation, they have AgentCore memory. They have AgentCore browser, they have AgentCore code interpreter, AgentCore this, AgentCore that. And it looks like some of them are with partnerships that they've done, you know, Datadog and some of the other partners that they've teamed up with. They have some Lambda functions in there as well. So I urge you to take a look at it if you're interested in what they're offering. Amazon always does a really good job in putting out information on their web pages as to what the products are with no nonsense, kind of very technical terms. And so kudos to them for doing that. But in, you know, my description would be it's a very complex set of existing products that they already had, probably some new innovative products that are in there as well that they've bundled together to kind of, you know, throw their hat into the agentic AI marketplace. It's probably the best way to describe it. So obviously this thing's going to provide interoperability and compatibility with the existing ecosystems that Amazon supports. So designed to support agent frameworks, foundation models, open source toolkits, including Crew AI, LongChain, LongGraph, AWS Strands, Agent SDK, compatible with industry standards like MCP and A2A. So in other words, they provide all the complete compatibility with what all the other cool kids are doing out there. So in essence, it's a set of products that's trying to get them parity in the market with what their other close competitors are doing, other cloud providers, of course, but also the rise of the mega startups that have occurred over the last 5 years around the generative AI, now agentic AI push. And so Amazon's trying to vie for relevancy, I guess, at the end of the day. We'll see how close they get. So while the press releases tout agent orchestration, modular frameworks, and developer enablement, really, I can't help but notice that the real-world value of agentic AI remains questionable. That's a big thing here, and that's not an AWS thing. I think that's a market thing. So when you look at what agentic AI does and the complexity it brings, very cool technology, but it shouldn't be over-applied. In other words, it's going to increase the cost, complexity, operational complexity of various systems. And so the over-application of it, I think, is going to be a danger for many of the enterprises out there. They want to do what the new modern architectures are doing. And we saw some of this with the microservices and cloud native stuff, where they force these architectures, in this case, this deployment model, on problem domains where they're not going to be able to provide value. So The big thing here is, are there enough problem domains out there that are really going to be a good fit for agentic AI that AWS is able to apply themselves to, or and other agentic vendors as well? I think it's much less than people think. I think we're overestimating the amount of work that's out there for agentic-based systems. I think it's a great technology and it's going to be applicable with a certain specific types of problems. I've used it many times in the past. However, it shouldn't be overapplied. It's going to bring additional costs, additional complexity, additional security issues. All these sorts of things are going to come along for the ride. And I think the enterprises are going to end up, at the end of the day, making wise decisions around whether agentic AI should be used or not. And in many instances, it's going to let down the technology providers who are believing, you know, that the agentic AI push is the second coming. Maybe it will, but I just don't see the number of requirements out there that are going to be needing agentic-based frameworks. So I think that the promise of broad, truly autonomous digital agents, you know, transforming businesses is firmly in the potential column. I don't think it's going to be a given that it's able to step in that space. You know, much more hype than substance at the end of the day. And in looking at AWS's new innovations, you know, kind of struck by how many components just look like repositioning of existing AI infrastructure, which it is, and other people's products. So, you know, AWS is going to do what lots of other technology companies do. They're going to try to sell what they already have, and they're going to repackage it as something that can be, you know, applied in the agentic space. It's actually, as a name, it's called agent washing. I'm quite sure that they have the capability to build and deploy very sound agentic AI systems, just like everybody else can do it at the same time. But there's not necessarily a secret sauce in there that's going to take them to the next level. They already had some downturns in the market. They're seeing some softening in the space. I think if they're looking for agentic AI to save them, I think that may be a fool's errand right now based on the space. I would focus on other innovations in the generative AI space and the ability to, you know, really kind of work on providing the best cloud, public cloud infrastructure out there, because that's why people leverage AWS, not necessarily for the products that are going to take them to some sort of new innovative levels. They're not relying on AWS for that anymore. So when looking at AgentCore, there's very little here that feels like genuine architectural rethink or, you know, a bold foray into new capabilities. Instead, I see a familiar AWS framework wrap existing services in new wrappers and hope enterprises will figure out, you know, why it matters. And, you know, that's my biggest concern. There's no clear business narrative for this. And so I think that many of, not just AWS, but many of the agentic players out there, people have agentic-based products. They truly have an agentic-based product, are expecting this huge transition in the marketplace. I'm pretty sure that that's not going to happen, at least at the scale they're expecting. So everybody who felt they missed the generative AI bubble, so to speak, has suddenly repositioned in agentic space, really kind of hoping that, well, they get that as well. It's very much like, you know, the rise of the internet in the 90s. Many companies, you know, jumped on the bandwagon, saw it coming, and were able to take advantage of it. Many more didn't until it was, you know, too late. And then they had to, you know, jump in at the last minute and therefore had to take their position in back of the market and battle their way up front. I don't think there's an inflection point that we're going to see around the agentic AI space. I think we're going to see interest in it and certainly interest in tools like AgentCore, but we're not going to see the absolute, you know, explosion in the market like we saw with the generative AI. It's going to have value, but it definitely doesn't have value in every space out there. So maybe I'm wrong and I'm underestimating what the market potential can be. But I'm looking at this stuff for the last 30 years. I'm pretty sure this is what the results are going to be. So the question really comes around this: why do companies actually need agentic AI at scale? You know, how will these tools translate into new business value or competitive edge beyond hobbyist demos or over-engineering architectures, which are going to be very disappointing? And I think that's the main question here. So in other words, in looking at the AWS stuff, yeah, it's okay. It's what I would expect that they pushed in the market. It's a bunch of their tools and technology that are bundled together to, you know, look at basically for them to explain relevancy in the agentic AI space, because they have to. The market's going to demand it. They kind of got some criticism in the fact they were a little too late to the generative AI marketplace, but AWS has always had some AI capabilities. I've used them personally and taught classes around them, things like that. But a couple of things that are going on with the agentic AI space. Number one, I don't think that the AgentCore stuff is going to provide AWS with a key innovative differentiator. In other words, it's just not there. There's nothing new in there into how, you know, people are leveraging those systems, just a bunch of technologies bound together. And also, I don't see the number of problem domains that are really going to warrant agentic AI, and this is industry-wide, not just AWS, are going to be out there in the numbers that I think the industry is expecting. So we may see some downsides, some disappointments, some misinvestment. We've done it in the past with other technologies. As far as enterprises go, they should kind of watch and wait, I think, before they jump into this, and also look at your own requirements. See if they're truly something that agentic AI is going to be able to help them with or not. And I think that's the story at the end of the day. We have to find the business value in this stuff. So I think AWS is a company that is probably operating under its potential right now. With its resources and talent, it should be leading the vision, clarity around tangible impact with things like agentic AI, simply not hopping on the latest AI buzzword train. So maybe future releases will prove me wrong and show real innovation in business outcome, but I haven't seen that lately from that company. So in other words, if you think of AWS, huge amounts of resources, huge amounts of talent in those organizations. Some of them just left. They were just laid off. So they're going to have to recover from that, figure out how they're going to take a very aggressive culture and point it toward a market that's going to need probably even more innovative and agile, you know, based outcomes in that space. And so, you know, they always call themselves the world's biggest startup, and they kind of have the culture. I would agree with that. I think at the core challenge now is for them to figure out a way to get into a market that's going to be dynamically changing, and make sure you don't alienate your existing usage on the system. In other words, my clients use AWS for the storage and compute and database service, things like that. And they have no intention of moving to agentic AI or even generative AI in the next few years. And they want those services to operate in efficient ways, reliable ways over a long period of time. AWS is pretty good at that. I would put your innovation and your investment in that first. In other words, you're going to provide the best sets of cloud services that may be boring old storage and boring old compute, but they're all, it's still very, very important to the businesses out there. I understand why you have to keep on the innovative edge, because people are going to expect that to happen, but be very careful with how you make your investments. Also, enterprises, be very careful on how you make your selections as well. We're in a world right now where it's going to be, you know, heterogeneous systems, best of breed technology, a mix of certainly public cloud providers like AWS, Microsoft, and Google. But we're also going to see a lot of usage of private clouds, which are much better than they were 10 years ago. Small tactical based specialized clouds like CoreWeave providing GPUs as service, sovereign clouds, you know, serving particular countries like little, and all kinds of different growths in different directions where people are going to be selecting the best of breed technology, which isn't necessarily going to be the large hyperscalers anymore. The cloud only days are over. So anyway, hope you enjoyed that. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and check out our other videos here. Also, check out my other stuff, InfoWorld Cloud Computing blog, 100 plus LinkedIn learning courses, and my book, An Insider's Guide to Cloud Computing. So until next time, you guys stay very safe. Cheers.